Hello friends, welcome back to Pathology Basics. So after a long time we are uploading another video. In the previous videos we have covered lymphoid neoplasms and lymphomas. We'll now be covering in this particular video myeloid neoplasms. So what do myeloid neoplasms include? So myeloid neoplasms include acute myeloid leukemias, myelodysplastic syndromes and myeloproliferative neoplasms. Acute myeloid leukemias are the ones in which you find myeloid blasts, that is the most primitive cells in the myeloid series, in the bone marrow as well as in the peripheral blood. Because of proliferation of these blasts, normal hematopoiesis is suppressed. In myelodysplastic syndromes, the myeloid progenitors, they have defective maturation, as a result of which it leads to cytopenias. And in myeloproliferative neoplasms, one or more of the myeloid cells, they proliferate. To understand this, let us see first of all the maturation series of the myeloid cells. As you can see over here, the maturation starts from the hematopoietic stem cell and it is then further divided into two main types, the lymphoid progenitor and the myeloid progenitor. Myeloid progenitor ultimately gives rise to the various granulocytes like the neutrophil, monocytes, eosinophil, basophils, as well as platelets through the megakaryocytes and erythrocytes through the erythroblasts. So in myeloid neoplasms, all of these or some of these cells, they increase in number, or in case of myelodysplastic syndromes, they increase in number in the bone marrow. So let us go into the specifics of these diseases. We'll start with acute myeloid leukemias. So acute myeloid leukemias, they are tumors of the hematopoietic progenitors. As is seen in almost all the tumors, they are caused by acquired mutations. It ultimately leads to impeded differentiation. Because differentiation is impeded, there is accumulation of myeloid blasts in the marrow. The replacement of marrow with blasts, it causes bone marrow failure and complications. Because there is bone marrow failure, there is ineffective hematopoiesis, there is anemia, platelets are less, there is thrombocytopenia, and because of deficiency of mature WBCs, there's neutropenia. The acute myeloid leukemia is of various types depending on which differentiation is impeded. The FAB classification or the French, American, British classification is a morphological classification based on which cell or which blast is increased in the bone marrow. M0, M1 and M2 are said to be the undifferentiated blasts, early myeloblasts and the late myeloblasts, that is seen in AML M0, M1 and M2. In AML M3, there are AML blasts, that is they are differentiated myeloid blasts. In AML M4 and M5, AML M4 and M5, it includes blasts which differentiate towards monocytes, that is monoblasts. AML M6, there is proliferation of the erythroblasts, and in AML M7, there is proliferation of the megakaryoblasts. So this is the classification in detail. M0, M1 and M2. M0 and M1, there is very less cytological maturation. We cannot classify them as M0 or M1 on the basis of morphology alone. Flow cytometric analysis is required. M2, there is significant maturation of the myeloid blasts. M3 is a specific variant called as promyelocytic leukemia. There is also an M3V, which is a hypogranular form of promyelocytic leukemia. M4, it includes myelomonocytic, M4 with eosinophilic and M4 with basophilic maturation. M5 is specifically monoblastic leukemia. Poorly differentiated monoblastic leukemia is M5A, and more differentiated is monoblastic or monocytic leukemia, M5B. M6 is erythroid leukemia, and M7 is megakaryoblastic leukemia. WHO classification, apart from the FAB classification we saw, it has included certain genetic variants. This is because targeted therapy is available for many of genetic mutations. Among them, AML with T821, it is basically the myelocytic variant of the FAB classification. AML with inversion 16 is myelocytic and monocytic one. And AML with trisomy T of T1517, it is the acute promyelocytic leukemia. Let's see the pathogenesis of acute myeloid leukemia. It basically happens due to mutations. Various mutations are known. One of them is in genes encoding transcriptions, in genes for growth factor signaling pathways, and due to epigenetic alterations. T821 and inversion 16 are the mutations happening in genes encoding transcriptions. T1517 is a mutation happening in growth factor signaling pathways. What happens due to T1517 is a fusion gene is created that encodes a chimeric protein. This chimeric protein consists of the retinoic acid receptor, or RAR alpha, and the protein that is formed, it's called PML. This fusion protein, what it does is it interferes with the terminal differentiation of granulocytes, and this effect is overcome by treatment with all trans retinoic acid or arsenic trioxide. Treatment with all trans retinoic acid in APML or acute promyelocytic leukemia has revolutionized the treatment. Earlier, what used to happen is the patient used to die due to complications of acute promyelocytic leukemia, such as DIC or disseminated intravascular coagulation. Giving all trans retinoic acid, a lot of patients recover. Epigenetic alterations are the most commonly mutated genes in AML, and specifically, there are problems with DNA methylation and histone modifications. What are the clinical features of AML? AML occurs at all ages, but more commonly the incidence is seen after 60 years of age. The patients present with anemia, neutropenia, as we already saw. Because of neutropenia, there are subsequent infections caused by opportunistic organisms such as fungi, pseudomonas, and the commensals. There is thrombocytopenia, which leads to cutaneous petechiae and ecchymosis. Patient also may present with bleeding tendencies, and this especially is seen in promyelocytic leukemia, that is AML with T1517. This is because the leukemic cells release procoagulants and fibrinolytic factors. There may also be bleeding in the serosal surfaces. Mucosal hemorrhages may be seen into the gingiva. Also, patient may bleed into the urinary tract. The AML cells may infiltrate the skin. This is called leukemia cutis or the gingiva. And this gingival infiltration is especially seen in tumors having monocytic differentiation. The AML cells occasionally may present as a soft tissue mass, and this has been variously named as a myeloblastoma or a granulocytic sarcoma or a chloroma. Central nervous system spread, it is less common in AML, it is more common in acute lymphocytic leukemia or ALL. Let's see the morphology of acute myeloid leukemia. The basic criteria is there should be at least 20% or more than 20% myeloid blasts in the bone marrow. In the peripheral blood, the presence of myeloblasts, it may be less than 20%, but if you see myeloblasts in the peripheral blood, it is always advisable to do a bone marrow. How do myeloblasts look like? Myeloblasts have delicate nuclear chromatin, as you can see over here. There may be 2 to 4 nucleoli. The cytoplasm, if you compare with lymphoblasts, it is more voluminous. But the cytoplasm, especially after M3 and M2, they contain fine azurophilic granules, and these azurophilic granules are MPO or myeloperoxidase positive. M3 blasts, they are promyelocytic leukemia blasts. They show distinct needle-like crystals called as the R rods, right? And they're particularly, as I said, numerous in AML with T1517. You can see over here these needle-like structures in the blasts. They are called R rods. M5 blast. That is monocytic blast. They have folded or lobated nuclei, as you can see over here. They lack R rods, and they are NSE or non-specific S-trace positive. Yeah, if you look at the blast on the top, it is having a folded nucleus, also called as lobated nucleus. This is non-specific S-trace staining in M5 blasts. M7 blasts, they show megakaryocytic differentiation. Megakaryocytic differentiation or M7 blastic leukemia is often accompanied by marrow fibrosis. This is because the megakaryocytes or megakaryoblasts, they release fibrogenic cytokines. AML diagnosis can be done by examination of the bone marrow and then immunohistochemistry staining, or it can, if you see blasts in the peripheral blood or even in the bone marrow, we can also utilize the help of flow cytometry. These are the markers that are commonly used for evaluation of AML. You can go through them at your leisure. It's nothing to explain as such. Progenitor cells or the M0, M1 leukemias, CD34 is very commonly used for that. MPO is used for M2 blasts and further. Monocytic blasts, they take up CD33, 14, 64 and CD36. Glycophorin A is a very common marker used for erythroid blasts. Megakaryocytic blasts, we use CD41 and CD61. Whereas lymphoid blasts, they are positive for CD19, 79A, CD10 and others. Prognosis, about 60% of patients of AML, they achieve remission with chemotherapy. But the 5-year survival is only 15 to 30%. AMLs with T1517, targeted therapy is available for this using all-trans retinoic acid and arsenic, and hence AML with T1517 is curable in more than 80% of the patients. AMLs with T1821 or inversion 16, they have relatively better prognosis with conventional chemotherapy. Therefore, WHO has put them in a separate category. Prognosis is dismal for acute myeloid leukemias that follow myelodysplastic syndromes, which we'll see now, or after genotoxic therapy. This is because they are mostly happening in older adults, and the problem is that these diseases are arising from a background of hematopoietic stem cell damage or depletion. That was AML. Now we come to myelodysplastic syndromes or MDS. Myelodysplastic syndromes are a group of disorders. They are clonal stem cells disorders. What is common between all these disorders is that it leads to ineffective hematopoiesis, number one, and number two, they have a high risk of transformation to AML. MDS is of two types, that is primary idiopathic, or it may be secondary to drug or radiation therapy, that is called TMDS. TMDS usually appears after 2 to 8 years of genotoxic therapy. As we already saw, all forms of MDS can transform to AML, but this transformation, it happens with higher frequency and more rapidly in TMDS. So, pathogenesis of myelodysplastic syndrome, again, as I said, they are clonal stem cell disorders, so mutations are seen. Many of the same mutations seen in AML can cause MDS. Again, epigenetic factors like DNA methylation and histone modifications can also lead to MDS. RNA splicing problems, especially at the 3 end of the RNA splicing machinery, mutations in transcription factor genes, loss of function of gene TP53, trisomy 9, increasing the oncoprotein MYC, and loss of one of the copy of a ribosomal protein encoding gene, RPS14, all these are implicated in MDS. Clinical features, predominantly it's a disease of the older adults, again 60 to 70 years of age. MDS is a specific disorder where it is discovered incidentally a lot of times on routine blood testing. That is, there are no specific symptoms as such in many of the patients. How do you classify MDS? MDS is classified on the basis of which cell is decreased in the peripheral blood. That is, there is cytopenia of which particular cell. WHO has given various categories. Category number one is refractory cytopenia with unilineage dysplasia. Unilineage dysplasia means there is dysplasia of one of the cell lines, either the erythroid or the platelets or the granulocytes. Second is refractory anemia with ringed sideroblast, where we see specific erythroid precursors called as the ringed sideroblasts. We'll see in detail later on. Refractory cytopenia with multilineage dysplasia, again as the name suggests, there is dysplasia in multiple lineages. Refractory anemia with excess blasts, refractory anemia with excess blasts 2. This is classified on the basis of number of blasts in the bone marrow. And MDS with isolated del 5q, that is put in a separate category. We will not be discussing in detail all of the different WHO classifications, but we'll see some common points about all of these. So morphologically, what is seen in MDS is there is dysplasia, that is the formation, or we can say the maturation is hindered. This may affect the erythroid, granulocytic, monocytic or megakaryocytic cell lines to varying degrees. What changes might be seen in erythroid series? In the erythroid series, there will be nucleated red cell progenitors, and that is the erythroblasts. They show multilobated or multiple kind of nuclei, that is the dysplasia seen in erythroid blasts. There may be ringed sideroblasts. Ringed sideroblasts are erythroblasts with iron laden mitochondria, and if you do a Prussian blue stain, you will see them as perinuclear granules, right? These are ringed sideroblasts. And the classification of WHO classification of MDS, as we saw earlier, shows specific entities with ringed sideroblasts. Also, erythroid series, the erythroblasts show megaloblastic maturation as seen in vitamin B12 and vitamin and folate deficiency. In the WBC series, the dysplasias can be seen in neutrophils. The neutrophils may be hyposegmented, they may be hypogranular as well. There is a specific entity called as Pelger-Hewitt hyposegmentation, where you see a spectacle kind of nucleus inside the neutrophil. You can see that clearly in this picture, right? The neutrophils may also contain toxic granulations or Dolly bodies. These are Dolly bodies. The basophilic inclusion seen inside the cytoplasm, that is called Dolly bodies. So this is seen in WBC series. In megakaryocytes or megakaryocytic series, the specific abnormality seen is called as a pon ball megakaryocyte. Pon balls are the structures that are seen outside pawn shops, and the megakaryocyte looks something like that. So it's called a pon ball megakaryocyte. The most important feature of MDS is that the myeloid blasts, though increased in number in bone marrow, they are not more than 20%. Prognosis of MDS, the median survival in patients with MDS ranges from 29 months. Progression to AML, it occurs in nearly 10 to 40% of the individuals. Patients succumb to complications of thrombocytopenia and neutropenia, that is bleeding and infection. Outlook is even worse in patients with TMDS whose survival is merely 4 to 8 months. In younger patients, stem cell transplantation has offered some hope of survival. So that was MDS. Then we'll come to myeloproliferative disorders. Myeloproliferative disorders, we'll be discussing four main myeloproliferative disorders, that is CML or chronic myeloid leukemia, PCV or polycythemia vera, essential thrombocytosis, and primary myelofibrosis. We'll be discussing four of these. The most common and important feature of myeloproliferative neoplasms is that there is marked increase in one or more of the cell lines, that is myeloid cell lines, both in the peripheral marrow or peripheral blood and bone marrow. This happens due to incorrect regulation of hematopoietic stem cells. Other characteristics common to myeloproliferative neoplasms is there is some cytogenetic abnormality. Patients always have extramedullary hematopoiesis, more commonly in the liver and the spleen. There is bone marrow fibrosis, and there are thrombotic or bleeding episodes. The myeloproliferative neoplasms, very specific characteristic is there is no dysplasia over here. Myeloproliferative neoplasms are classified on the basis of which cell line is the most affected, though there is a minor variant of the other cell lines also being affected in the myeloproliferative neoplasms. Chronic myeloid leukemia, the cell line that is affected is the myeloid granulocytic granulocytic cell series. In neutrophilic leukemia, you can see a lot of mature neutrophils. In eosinophilic leukemia, there are eosinophils that are increased. Essential thrombocythemia, more commonly the platelets are increased in number. Primary myelofibrosis, fibrosis of the marrow, polycythemia vera, and unclassifiable MPN. We'll be discussing the four most common of them. Let us start with chronic myeloid leukemia with BCR-ABL translocation. Chronic myeloid leukemia, the definition has now included it as being a one with BCR-ABL translocation, where portions of BCR gene on chromosome 22 and ABL gene on chromosome 9, they are translocated. This is called Philadelphia chromosome also. It directs the synthesis of a constitutively active BCR-ABL tyrosine kinase. What happens due to that is it drives the proliferation of granulocytic and megakaryocytic progenitors, right? So granulocytic and megakaryocytic cell lines are affected over here, and there is abnormal release of immature granulocytic forms like the myelocytes and the metamyelocytes from the marrow into the blood. Also, neutrophils are increased in number, and basophils also start appearing in the peripheral blood. This is what happens. There is translocation from 22 to 9, right? So there is a fusion protein created, BCR-ABL, and this causes growth factor independent proliferation and survival of the myeloid progenitors. Clinically, the patient presents, usually they are in their 5th to 6th decades of life. The onset is insidious. Patient slowly starts getting fatigue early. There is weakness, weight loss, and anorexia. Sometimes the patient may present only with a dragging sensation in the abdomen and splenomegaly. Then there may be acute onset of the left upper quadrant pain due to splenic infarction. Splenomegaly and hepatomegaly over here are primarily due to extramedullary hematopoiesis, that is because the bone marrow is filled with progenitors and there is ineffective erythropoiesis, New erythropoiesis starts in the liver and in the spleen. There may be anemia, mild to moderate. Also, because there is a lot of cell turnover, it may lead to hypermetabolism and hyperuricemia. CML presents in four phases: chronic phase, accelerated phase, blast phase, and resistant CML. Early patients present in the chronic phase, right? They are diagnosed, that is 90% of the patients who are diagnosed are in chronic phase. This can last for several years. Important characteristic is that the blood and bone marrow, it contains 10% blasts or even less than 10% blasts. The defining criteria for CML is that the blasts in the bone marrow should be less than 20%. They contain on an average around 10% blasts. Without effective treatment, this chronic phase can either progress to accelerated phase or blastic phases. In accelerated phase, the definition is there are around 10 to 19% of the blasts either in the blood or in the bone marrow, or they may have more than 20% basophils in the peripheral blood. So that's very specific criteria. So what happens in the accelerated phase is there are additional mutations apart from the Philadelphia chromosomes that lead to more number of blasts in the blood or in the bone marrow. Next phase is the blast phase, also called blast crisis, and the criteria is there should be more than 20% blasts in the blood or bone marrow. In 70% of the cases, the blasts are myeloid in origin. We call it myeloid blast crisis, whereas in remainder, they may be lymphoid blasts. Also, there are again additional genetic mutations that leads to blast crisis. CML resistant phase, we call that CML resistant which comes back after treatment or does not respond to treatment at all. The morphology, how does CML look on peripheral smear? On the peripheral smear, there will be leukocytosis. Often it exceeds 1 lakh cells per cubic millimeter. Predominantly the cells are kind of mature cells like neutrophils and band forms. They form one peak, and metamyelocytes and myelocytes, they form another peak. There may be eosinophils and basophils as well. Blasts, they are usually less than 10% of the circulating cells in chronic phase. Platelets, they may be increased markedly most of the times, and therefore there is thrombocytosis. In the marrow, there is massively increased number of maturing granulocytic precursors, right? So we are talking about myelocytes and metamyelocytes over here. There may be elevated proportion of eosinophils and basophils as well. Megakaryocytes are also increased in number. Remember, it causes thrombocytosis on peripheral smear. Megakaryocytes may sometimes be small and dysplastic. The erythroid progenitors, they may be normal or may be mildly decreased. The characteristic finding is presence of macrophages which contain green blue cytoplasm, the so-called sea blue histiocytes. So this sea blue histiocytes is a typical feature of chronic myeloid leukemia. Prognostically, BCR-ABL inhibitors like imatinib are now available, and this results in very nice remission, sustained remission in more than 90% of patients. However, the catch is that not all the cells go away in the marrow. There are stem cells which persists at lower levels, right? This form of targeted therapy but still does control the blood counts and decreases the risk of transformation to accelerated phase and blast crisis. If the patient is young, hematopoietic stem cell transplantation can be performed, and it is curative in 75% of the cases. So that was CML or chronic myeloid leukemia. Let's move to second important myeloproliferative disorder called polycythemia vera. Polycythemia vera, as the name suggests, it's due to increased marrow production of red cells mainly, and small amounts of granulocytes and platelets are also increased, therefore it is called panmyelosis. The increase in red cells, that is polycythemia, is responsible for most of the symptoms of polycythemia vera. It is very important to distinguish polycythemia from other causes of polycythemia, right? Like hemoconcentration, dehydration, these are all relative causes of polycythemia and they must be ruled out before diagnosing polycythemia vera. The mutation that is most commonly associated with polycythemia vera is in tyrosine kinase JAK2. So the pathogenesis underlies mutation in JAK2 signaling pathway. Normally there is a negative feedback mechanism, that is when the erythropoietin is acting, it leads to activation of genes for growth and proliferation of red cells, and there is a negative feedback regulation. When the JAK2 is mutant, this negative feedback regulation is lost and it leads to unregulated RBC production or polycythemia vera. Clinical features, it is mainly seen in adults of the late middle age. All the symptoms are primarily due to increased red cell mass and hematocrit. The patients become plethoric and sometimes cyanotic, and this happens due to stagnation of blood in the peripheral vessels. There is increased risk of both bleeding as well as thrombotic episodes. Bleeding and thrombotic episodes, they increase because of polycythemia and sometimes due to increased platelet counts. The thrombotic episodes arise because of deep vein thrombosis. It leads to embolism, myocardial infarction, stroke. It may block the hepatic vein, producing Budd-Chiari syndrome. And portal and mesenteric vein thrombosis may lead to bowel infarction. Polycythemia vera also presents with the basophils that are increased in polycythemia vera may lead to intense pruritus and peptic ulceration because of release of histamine. High cell turnover may lead to hyperuricemia and gout. In the peripheral blood, morphology is as follows. The RBCs, the hemoglobin concentration, if you see, will be in the range of 14 to 28 gram per deciliter, and hematocrit is 60% or more. The white blood cell count ranges from 12,000 to 50,000, and platelet counts may be greater than 5 lakhs. There is increased number of basophils as well. Platelets may exhibit morphologic abnormalities such as giant forms, and the platelets may also be defective in functional studies. Marrow, if you see, in the early phase it is hypercellular. There is subtle increase in red cell progenitors, WBCs and platelet progenitors. There may be marked or moderate increase in reticulin fibers if you do a reticulin stain, and mild organomegaly may be there, but this is mainly due to congestion at this stage and not due to extramedullary hematopoiesis. In late phase there is extensive marrow fibrosis, and this displaces all the hematopoietic cells from the marrow. Also, when the marrow is depleted of the hematopoietic cell, extramedullary hematopoiesis starts, that is seen in spleen and liver, and leads to prominent organomegaly of spleen and liver. Prognosis, without treatment, polycythemia vera patient dies because of bleeding or thrombosis. However, the simple treatment is maintaining the red cell mass, and this is done by phlebotomy, that is removal of blood, and this extends the median survival up to 10 years. Targeted therapy in the form of JAK2 inhibitors, it is in development phase and it may represent a very promising form of targeted therapy. Next form is essential thrombocytosis, and this mainly refers to increased platelets. So it manifests with elevated platelet counts in absence of increased red cell mass. Causes of reactive thrombocytosis such as inflammation, iron deficiency, etc. should be excluded before the diagnosis, same way as we have to exclude causes of reactive polycythemia in case of polycythemia vera. It is caused due to mutations in JAK2 or MPL. The clinical features, it usually occurs after the age of 60. There is dysfunction of platelets, and this can lead to thrombosis and hemorrhage. Type of thrombotic events, it usually resembles that seen in polycythemia vera, which includes deep vein thrombosis, hepatic vein thrombosis and Budd-Chiari syndrome, myocardial infarction and stroke. Typical symptom in essential thrombocytosis is erythromelalgia. It is a throbbing and burning of hands and feet, and this happens because of occlusion of small arterioles of hands and feet because of aggregation of platelets. Morphologically, if you see on peripheral smear, abnormally large platelets are seen called as megathrombocytes. In bone marrow, the megakaryocytes are increased in number and there are abnormally large form of megakaryocytes that are seen. Prognostically, it is an indolent disorder. It is seen in having asymptomatic periods and there is occasional thrombotic or hemorrhagic crisis in these asymptomatic periods. Median survival is 12 to 15 years and the therapy consists of gentle chemotherapy agents that suppress thrombopoiesis. The last disorder of primary myeloproliferative disorder group we are going to discuss is primary myelofibrosis. As the name suggests, there is fibrosis of the marrow in this disorder. Primary myelofibrosis is replacement of the marrow by fibrous tissue that is primarily collagen. This reduces bone marrow hematopoiesis and leads to cytopenias because there is decreased hematopoiesis in the marrow. There is extensive extramedullary hematopoiesis in the liver and spleen. Collagen deposition is happening because of release of fibrogenic factors from the neoplastic megakaryocytes. Again, JAK2 mutations are present in this disorder also. Clinically, again, older age patients, more than 60 years of age, it comes to attention because of anemia, again splenomegaly because of extramedullary hematopoiesis, and hyperuricemia and gout. Morphologically, on the peripheral smear, you can see leukoerythroblastosis, that is nucleated RBCs are seen on the peripheral smear. You can see teardrop shaped RBCs on the peripheral smear, also called dacryocytes. These dacryocytes are formed because of damage during the birthing process in the fibrotic marrow. If you see the bone marrow early changes, you will see hypercellular marrow. The erythroid and granulocytic precursors are normal, but the megakaryocytes are large and dysplastic and clustered, as you can see here in this figure. At the early stage, fibrosis is minimal, but in the late stage, the fibrosis is dense, the marrow becomes hypercellular and diffusely fibrotic, as you can see over here in this particular picture. And at very late stage, the marrow may be replaced by bone called as osteosclerosis. You can see clusters of atypical megakaryocytes with unusual nuclear shapes called as cloud-like. The prognosis, median survival is very poor, 3 to 5 years. JAK2 inhibitors, let us see whether they help or not. They have recently been approved to treat this disease. Threats to life, they include intercurrent infections, thrombotic episodes, bleeding tendencies, and transformation to AML or acute myeloid leukemia. Hematopoietic stem cell transplantation will offer hope in young and fit patients. So thank you very much for tuning in to Pathology Basics. Hope this clears some of your concepts regarding myeloid neoplasms. If you like this lecture, please like, share and subscribe to our channel. Please share with your friends and support us. Thank you.